Yeah. this. I hope somebody gets this message because we want you to feel special today. So, yes, Christina.
Or to new mothers to be.
That's right. Expecting mothers, you have a lot to look forward to. A lot of responsibility, a lot of work, and it's hard. But there, it is a blessing from God. And today's message, what I entitled it was, Mothers, God Sees You. Okay? Sometimes we don't see you. sometimes we're, us guys, we're caught up in other things. We don't see you like we should see you. Husbands, you know, partners. But God sees you, and today we're going to learn how God feels about you. Okay. Although we do appreciate you. When you mention the word mother, what do you think of? Anybody? What do you think of? I'm not asking you if you think about your own mom, but when you think about the description of a mother, what are some things that come to your mind?
Kids.
Kids, right?
Nurturing.
Yeah, Christina?
Duties.
Lots of things, right? Are you thinking, Lona? Stuff I gotta do, right? Mothers are busy, very busy. This is something that was shared that I came across, and so I wanted to share this with you. A group of second graders were asked what they thought about their mother. Second graders. They were asked various questions about their moms, and their answers are fascinating. So, why did God make mothers? This is what they said. These are the responses to the questions. These are second graders. To help us when we were getting born. That's what one of them said. How did God make mothers? Magic plus superpowers and a lot of stirring. What ingredients are mothers made of? God makes mothers out of clouds and angel hair and everything nice in the world and one dab of meanness. What did God give your mother and not some other mother? God knew she would like me a lot more than other people's moms would like me. What kind of a little girl was your mother? I don't know, because I wasn't there. But my guess would be pretty bossy. But they did say she used to be nice. Second graders. Why did your mom marry your dad? She got too old to do anything else with him. Who is the boss at your house? Mom is. She doesn't want to be, but she has to because dad is such a goofball. What's the difference between moms and dads? Moms work at work and work at home, and dads just go to work and work at work. There's some truth to that. What does your mom do in her spare time? Mothers don't do spare time. What would it take to make your mom perfect? On the inside, she's already perfect. On the outside, some type of plastic surgery.
Wow.
I'm making it up. If you could change one thing about your mom, what would it be? I would like her to get rid of those eyes in the back of her head. If you have a Bible close to you, I'm going to turn to the Proverbs, the 31st chapter. And I'm just going to share with you what the Bible says about women. Proverbs chapter 31. Proverbs chapter 31. And I just want you to keep this in mind. The father may be the head of the house, and the children the hub of the home, but without question, the mother is the heart of the house. Little babies even sense it from the time they're born. From the time they're born. There's just a connection because the heart is in the mother. Okay? This is an interesting point. I'm fascinated to learn that in almost every language on earth, the word for mother begins with the letter M. You know why that fascinates me? That may be due to the fact that babies all over the world, they say, learn the consonant M first. Before any other consonant. Not sure what the connection is there, but it is interesting. That right from the start, they're drawn to communicate with their mother. That interesting. This chapter is the longest description of any family member found in the Bible. So I want you to think about that wherever you're seeing this message. This chapter in the Bible, and that tells you something. It's the longest description of any family member in the Bible. This verse, what's really amazing is that the verse is what they call acrostic. And the word acrostic has to do with how something is written. Each verse in the original language, which we didn't speak the original language, but if we did, we note this. Each verse of this chapter begins with a succeeding letter of the Hebrew alphabet. Isn't that interesting? It's a special artistic description placed in the Bible of this special family member of a mother. So basically, what this means is that each verse begins with the succeeding letter of the Hebrew alphabet and goes from one end of the alphabet to the other. So basically, it's like saying, this is the description of this family member from A to Z. This is the whole thing. And this was placed in the Bible by God. And so we're being told from A to Z here in Proverbs 31. What a wonder a woman and a mother is for the home. And so we're going to talk about a few different things before we separate here. And Proverbs chapter 31, and I'm just going to read a few verses here. Beginning in verse 10, portraits of a virtuous woman. Okay? Proverbs 31. Who can find a virtuous woman? For her price is far above rubies. The heart of her husband doth safely trust in her, so that he shall have no need of spoil. She will do him good and not evil all the days of her life. She seeketh wool and flax and worketh willingly with her hands. She's like a merchant's ship and brings her food from afar. She riseth also while it is yet night, and giveth food to her household and a portion to her maidens. She considereth a field and buyeth it. With the fruit of her hands she planteth a vineyard. She girdeth her loins with strength and strengtheneth her arms. She perceiveth that her merchandise is good, her lamp goeth out by night. She layeth her hands to the spindle, and her hands hold the staff. She stretcheth out her hand to the poor. She reacheth forth her hands to the needy. She is not afraid of the snow for her household, for all her household are clothed with scarlet. She maketh herself coverings of tapestry. Her clothing is silk and purple. Her husband is known in the gates when he sitteth among the elders in the land. She maketh fine linen, and selleth it, and delivereth girdles unto the merchant. Strength and honor are her clothing, and she shall rejoice in time to come. She openeth her mouth with wisdom. In her tongue is the law of kindness. She looketh well to the ways of her household, and eateth not the bread of idleness. Her children rise up and call her blessed. Her husband also, and he praiseth her. Many daughters have done virtuously, but thou excellest them all. Favor is deceitful, and beauty is vain, but a woman who feareth the Lord shall be praised. Give her of the fruit of her hands, and let her own works praise her in the gates. Isn't that pretty? For women. For mothers. Those are beautiful verses. The word excellent, right? Keep in mind that what's described here in these verses is the ideal, right? It's not a standard that every mother can achieve. And not every mother's going to achieve every standard in here. There may be some specific powerful similarities to certain things you see in the Bible's description of a God-fearing woman here. Just keep that in mind. Okay. But it's something for you to try to aspire to, right? You can see the value in it. And I just want to ask you before we go on to a couple points. There's 3 points we're going to do real quick before we stop. What are the things about a mother that you've seen described there in God's inspired book in Proverbs 31? Is there anything that you picked out that reminded you of your life? We're going to talk about some of these verses. And I guarantee you that some of these verses, you're going to be like, that's me. I do that. And maybe you don't even think about it, and you do it. Okay, so let's talk about some of this. An excellent wife who can find. She is far more precious than jewels. What I want you to do when you leave here, you can feel special too, Bob, but I want the mothers to leave here, and I want you to feel how God is feeling about you. You made it to church today, you're making an effort, right? We're not perfect. We make mistakes, but we're trying, right? And so how God is going to feel about you, I want you to feel special when you leave. If you're watching this, I want you to take away, the main takeaway from this is that you're special and that God sees you. God sees you. And if you're feeling neglected and others aren't seeing your work, just know that God is seeing you. God is seeing you. I know there are some mothers, right, that are, you know, they're not going to get much attention from their partner. It could be a sad situation for them. But we want you to know that God sees you. He's seeing you. I think it's important. Main takeaway for this. So keep those thoughts in mind. We get into this. The word excellent wife, who can find her, refers to moral strength, spiritual strength, a woman of tremendous character, integrity. Women, just like men, are a dime a dozen, right? There's a lot of women and there's a lot of men. But a woman of honor and virtue and character are, what's the word I would use? Priceless. Right? Priceless. Special. That is why he does not ask, who can buy an excellent wife? Where's an excellent wife? Where do I go to get her? That's not what it says. It said, who can find her? Who can find her? Because this kind of woman is not for sale. He says, who can find her? You got to look for this kind of woman. You got to look for her. Sometimes it takes us a long time to find somebody like that. Right? You've got to look for her. It's easy to find a woman with good looks. You know, it's easy to find someone that's pretty. You might even want somebody that's funny, that makes you laugh. You can find those. There are people like those. A successful woman with style or education. But the first thing every single man needs to know is that he ought to look for a woman with virtue and character, spirituality, and godliness. Because that's what's identified there in the Bible. And that's what makes you special. And that's what God is seeing in so many of you. There are these are the things that last. In fact, these are the things that make a woman truly beautiful. You heard the old saying, beauty is only skin deep? You've heard that, right? Someone put it this way. Beauty is only skin deep. Ugly goes to the bone. Beauty simply fades away. Ugly holds its own. Wrinkles come, body sag, back stoop, legs give out, but a good, godly heart is full of grace, is strong to the end. So, for everybody, every male that may be watching this, every young man that's watching this, I just want to say this. If you're out there and you're looking to get married, that there's two most important things and decisions that you're going to make in your life. So we're just going to say a couple things to men here. Two most decisions. One decision is the Lord you're going to serve. That's one of the most biggest decisions you're going to make. What's the second one? The second one is, who will you marry? Who will you marry? It's a big decision. The lady you will marry. The first decision will determine whether you experience heaven or earth or hell, right? In the life to come. Do you know where I'm going with this one? The second decision will determine whether you experience heaven or hell in the life now. So, those two choices are important for you. Okay, amen? How do I know this is referring to the character of a woman? How do you think her worth is compared to rubies instead of diamonds? Why do you think it's the case? Here he says that this kind of woman is like rubies. You might think, well, you know, they're more like diamonds, right? They're priceless. We think of the tagline for diamonds as being priceless. Does anybody have any idea why he might have used, God might have inspired the word ruby to be used instead of a diamond? Okay, there's a specific reason though. That's a good answer. They are worth a lot.
There's several references to scarlet.
Okay.
The color red.
That's true.
The color red and the rubies go kind of hand in hand with the messages that he wants to give about women towards women.
Okay, that's good. Yeah, that's good. Good answer. This is what I think, okay? See how you feel about this. A diamond catches the light and reflects it. That's what a diamond is. Its beauty is in the fact that it reflects, it catches the light and it reflects it. Right? A flawless diamond is reflecting a beautiful light. What makes a ruby beautiful is its inner glow. Its inner glow. The beauty of a diamond is on where?
Outside.
Out here. That's on the outside. That's not what God wanted you to think about a valuable woman. He didn't want you to think about it being on the outside, which to me shows me that, you know, the Bible is truly inspired of God. To come up with a description like that, and now we think about it, we think, well, why would he say ruby? Diamonds are precious too. We all know that, right? The beauty of the diamond is on the outside. The beauty of the ruby is on the inside. If you find a woman who's beautiful on the inside, then you will have a woman who will be beautiful all of her life. All of her life. She's going to be beautiful. Amen. That's the kind of woman that God describes. That's the kind of woman that he sees in you. Right? Then he says in verse 11, the heart of her husband trusts her and will have no lack of gain. We're going to go through these kind of quick. A few little points here. as any married couple that has ever been betrayed by their spouse will tell you, when trust goes out the door, love often goes out the window. The framing of a marriage is love, but the foundation of marriage is trust, right? Yeah. A woman of character can be trusted, right? That's part of it. As you will see, he's speaking here primarily in the area of, in this documentation, he's speaking primarily in the area of finances. So, managing them. It's great when you don't have to worry about the money and when you know a dollar is being stretched and used wildly. wisely. From the beginning of a lot of marriages, men learn pretty rapidly, often, that women are a little bit better in the department of budgeting. They're better at budgeting, they're better at, you know, keep making deals, keeping track of things. I know in my experience, that's the case. So if you've been blessed in that way, you understand what God is describing here as valuable that He sees in you. Okay. So, a woman like this has trust not just in the way she manages a home, but in the way she manages herself. Amen. What is the mark of a good wife and a good mother? She is good to her husband and good for her husband and her family. So Proverbs 31 says, she does good, does not harm all the days of her life. She's a fountain of a blessing that never runs dry. She does her family good in so many ways. She's the greatest encourager. She's the number one cheerleader. She never, speaks evil of her family. She tries to be positive. And these are special qualities that God is, He's identifying here for us. Okay. To put it simply, and in most cases, the woman is oftentimes what God sees in so many homes is the model of character in the home. The model of character. I like to think of men as being great, but we're pretty simple. When it comes to character, generally it's the woman in the home that brings character to the house. Right? I think that most of us will attest to this. In our experience, that's been the case. Mom is a trendsetter. Mothers are a trendsetter. And a woman of godly character is the rock and the steadying influence in homes. So I want you to know how special you are. If you've undertaken that role and you've taken that role seriously, that's what God is seeing in you. That's what He's seeing in you. Now, we're going to talk about competency in the home. What a godly mother provides there. We begin to see the various things that mothers do provide a happy home for both the dad and the kids. I want you to see if you see these in yourself. I'm looking out at you and I'm already seeing. You're not going to have to go very far to see the similarity in what you're doing right now. She seeks wool and flax and works with willing hands. What does that indicate? She's doing. Everybody needs to be clothed and clothed well. Wool was for winter and flax was for summer. In that day, it was the job of the woman to make the clothes, and she did it with willing hands. The word willing literally means delightful. Delightful. She did it with delightful hands. So she enjoyed it. This was not a woman who had to be home. She wanted to be home. Right? So, and we're going to get into working women too here in just a second. But here we're talking about a woman at home who's making clothes. Right? So God here, He's describing a woman who's making sure that the kids are clothed, that they have the clothes they need. And I can assume that if you have children, or you've raised children, who's the first one to think about clothes when it comes time to school starting up. It's not the man who may want to help provide for them and may even go shopping for you, but it's the mother who knows what the kids need, who looks for those things, tries to make the children happy and make the budget happy, right? That's what happens. That's what I've seen. That's probably what most of us have seen. So that's what he's talking about there. It's not that she had to be home, but she wanted to be home to take care of those things. She didn't see what she did as a duty, but as a delight, because she loved her family. And I think that's, you're shaking your heads. You felt that way, right? Yeah. Okay. Families have to eat. So we read in verse 14 and 15, she's like the ships of the merchant. She brings in the food from afar. She rises up while it is still night and provides food for her household and portions for her maidens. Okay? This is a woman who is not afraid to go the extra mile to find a bargain and to find the best food. You know, if I want something to eat, I just go get whatever is on the shelf. That's how we work, right? But women will look for the bargain. They'll look for the better thing, the quality thing. They want the best for their family. This is what God is describing. These are His verses here. Yasmin, how you doing?
Good.
Nice to see you.
Uh-huh, nice to
see you.
Yeah. We look for sales.
Right? Okay. And here's another thing. So I went through that. Let's go to verse 16. It says, she considers a field and buys it. Out of her earnings, she plants a vineyard. Okay? Here's the subject we mentioned. Evidently, here he's describing a worker, a working mother. She had some type of job outside of her home, which allowed her to make some money. She could plant a vineyard, make some extra money in case her family needed it. Okay, so just a side note, if you're, thank God for those mothers who get to stay home. Thank God for mothers who work for both. There are many moms that would love to stay home with their kids, but they have to work and they have to make ends meet. My mom, there was a period of time when she stayed home with us all the time. And there was a period of time where she worked with my dad and they worked together. Okay. She worked for most of her life. But when we were little, I was blessed with her being home all the time. She had to help my dad meet the expenses of our home, so they both went to work. And that's the case. That's what God's describing here, and that's what He sees in you. If you are married to a woman who works both outside as well as in the home, do me a favor. Do God a favor, because that's what God sees. So I just want to say this. Cut her some slack. Cut her some slack. Be thankful for her. Be patient with her. And not be so demanding if she doesn't get what you want done. Amen. There was a working mother who was doing her best at her job and in her home to be the best mother she could be. Her husband was always complaining. And one day as they got out of bed, he looked at her and said, he was always complaining, lacked compassion for her working so hard. And he says, can't you ever fix me a hot breakfast? And she reaches in her drawer and gives him a match and says, go set your cornflakes. Fuck. This is a true story. So she felt unappreciated. That mother had it together. Even though she didn't cook breakfast. Right? She was trying to get a lot done and she was working. So we need to remember that. That mother had it together. The Bible says in Proverbs 31, she sets food about her work vigorously. Her arms are strong for her tasks. She sees that her training is profitable and her lamp does not go out at night. So when we're sleeping, they're still thinking about, what's going to be for dinner tomorrow. What are they going to cook for breakfast? Things that we may not be thinking about. It's on their head. In her hand, she holds the distaff and grasps the spindle with her fingers. It continues. Obviously, this is when she sat down to make the clothes that we referred to earlier. This is a woman who has a practical knowledge of how to do the things necessary to keep a household together. In the best sense of the term, she is a home... What's the word? A homemaker. Homemaker. She is the glue that holds it all together. She is the good mother who works hard, and she is working hard to be a good mother. That's what I see here with the sisters that we have here. Okay. Suffice to say, while a lot of men are making huge achievements, they can really be thankful and give credit to those achievements to their partners who in the background have worked so hard while they're working on those things. Proverbs 31:23. Here's the cool part. Her husband is respected at the city gate, where he takes his seat among the elders of the land. Okay. The city gate was the place where civic business was transacted. It functioned as an office for many in the community. Her husband was even on the city council. This was a man that was successful. And why was he successful? Because of his hard work, right? Yeah. So we can say it loud and proudly that a lot of times men would not be who they are today had it not been for the sweetest, prettiest, loveliest lady in their life. Hopefully when you read Proverbs 31, you think of your partner. Amen. She watches over the affairs of her household and does not eat the bread of idleness. The bottom line is, this woman he's describing runs a tight ship. How many times has a man felt like, you know, maybe your partner's running too tight of a ship? What? How much can I possibly accomplish, right? If she's got a tight ship, there's things that she wants to, there's things going on for her. She's trying to create, be a home builder. Let's see. When the husband is at work or out of town or the children are at school, they don't have to worry about the home. They know they've got mom at the wheel. She doesn't eat the bread of idleness, not because of the bread of idleness is not good, but because she doesn't have time. She's got a lot going on. So, forgive us men. Forgive us men. Right? Forgive us men. And God forgive all of us husbands and fathers who ever thought that wives have it easy. I think sometimes men think they do. So let me give you a piece of advice. If you've had this kind of woman in your home as a wife and a mother like this, you're getting off cheap. Every year, salary.com gives the compensation comparison of what a stay-at-home mother is worth in the United States workforce. Taking into account she is a nurse, a homemaker, a chef, a janitor, an accountant, a teacher, a chauffeur, 24/7. What would it cost on a salary to hire a person to take care of all those things? Realistically, do you have an idea what it might cost?
$700 an hour.
Well, I'm going to give you the price they gave at one point, and then you're probably going to think, there's nothing. Okay. So this is what they said. It would call for a salary of $138,000 in the same range as a law school professor, pediatrician, if it was given a cost or value. So be thankful, be appreciative. Never take them for granted. The problem is sometimes what a person doesn't get noticed, what do they do when they don't get noticed? It's that. Yeah. So if you have a woman that's working hard, trying to be a good mother, trying to keep up, trying to be devoted to the Lord, sometimes if she's not noticed, then you find her just, you know, that's it. I'm done. I'm checked out. And we don't want that to happen. So we want to make sure that we notice and we're thankful. A godly mother also promotes chemistry in the home. So I'm going to get into this for a minute because most of you are going to, you know, you're going to connect with this pretty quick. There is a truth to the fact that when mom is happy, everyone is happy. It's a long-known rule for men that if we can somehow keep women happy or our partners happy, everybody in the house is going to be happy. Okay? And you're probably thinking, well, that's true of you too. It probably is. But today's your day. So, It's not just this way, just the way this particular wife and mother works that's fantastic, but in the way she talks. Okay? So the Bible says she speaks with wisdom. Faithful instruction is on her tongue. She speaks with wisdom. So she doesn't try to yell, scream, raise her voice. And anyone knows that a mother's voice is like soothing music, which sweetens the atmosphere of a home. She is wise in what she says and kind in the way she says it. That's usually how it starts, right? She is a master teacher. Some of the greatest life lessons you'll ever learn can be only taught by a mother. There was one article that said, things only a mom can teach. My mother taught me anticipation. Just wait until we get home. Anticipation. My mother taught me about receiving. You're going to get it when we get home. my mother taught me logic. If you fall out of that swing and break your neck, you're not going to the store with me anymore. My mother taught me physiology. If that lawnmower cuts off your toes, don't come running to me. My mother taught me about genetics. You are just like your father. This is my favorite. My mother taught me about justice. One day you will have kids, and I hope they turn out just like you. Then you will see what it's like. By the way, isn't it amazing how we teach our kids the same thing our mothers taught us? Right? Okay. Then we read this. Just about the time we feel that our mothers truly are wonderful in all their work, we read this. Her children rise up and call her blessed. Her husband also, and he praises her. Many women have done excellently, but you surpass them all. The suggestion here is this praise was expressed regularly. It was expressed consistently. It was expressed spontaneously. It was expressed lovingly and not just on Mother's Day. Right? You see, they didn't have Mother's Day in Israel. They didn't. The truth of the matter is every day should be Mother's Day and every day should be Father's Day. There's a debt we owe to all of our mothers that we can never repay. But we ought to make installments every day.